Hi, everybody.
Hi, Brian.
I think it's on.
Check, check.
Hey, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Hi.
Hi.
What's up, Tony?
There it is. Nice. Are we good? Are we going? Are you going to roll the graphic?
I'm bagging this bitch.
Yes. Hello, everybody, and welcome to what I believe we're calling is the Devil May Cry 5 launch party cross IGN First Friday, presented by Devil May Cry 5.
That's right.
I'm Max Scovo. This is Brian Altano.
Hi.
From Capcom. This is Matt Walker.
Hi.
And we are here, surprise, surprise, to talk about Devil May Cry 5, which is out today. That is Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and PC, I believe.
I think you're right.
Yeah.
Sweet. That's
right.
Sweet, yeah. So presumably everybody could be out there playing it right now, but huge thank you to everybody who's instead here hanging out or watching this, wherever we put it out there on the internet. I kind of just wanted to pick your brain, Matt, because the game is out now. The cat's out of the bag, and you can actually talk about it a bit.
All right. Well, before we do that, Max, I'm going to just totally throw a wrench in your plans here. Today is International Women's Day, right?
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
Give it up.
Right?
It is.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, look, we're at Capcom. We're super excited that Devil May Cry's coming out. But I think it's really important to first kind of pay respect to all the kick-ass women that have worked on the game but are also here today. So, I mean, just if you guys just don't mind really quick, I know we got on production over here, we have Amanda and Anne. If you guys want to come up here, that's fine. If not, that's okay. Just want to give a round of applause to you guys and Charlene, the brand manager on Devil May Cry 5. Char, you'll come up here, right? Yeah, Char, what's up, baby?
There it is.
Hey. Hey Matt, thank you. But this is all about you today. This isn't the Char party, it's the Matt Walker party.
No. No, I mean,
International Matt Walker Day is tomorrow.
No one should ever.
It's actually
have
a regional territory based thing. It's only National Matt Walker Day.
It's just in a little. It's a little place in Matsuyamachi in Osaka is all it is. But no, I mean, seriously, like, you know, there are a ton of kick-ass women that work on games, that work in games, that work at IGN every day. They have a lot of shit to put up with, and they excel. Exceed is a term from Devil May Cry 5, so I guess that's why that was in my brain. But anyways, look, just really quick, can we just all give a round of applause to all the kick-ass women working here today?
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
That is a totally acceptable monkey wrench.
You gotta sparkle it out. See, if you're gonna do a fist bump with me, I'm all about glitter. So you gotta like sparkle it out. All right, so let's do it.
There
that's
it is.
Right.
That stuff gets everywhere,
yeah.
By the way. It's
yeah,
great.
Yeah. It's basically, it's craft shrapnel. But anyway, thank you. Thank you so much, Matt. Thank you so much, IGN.
Thank you.
For letting
thank
us
you.
Come here and
of course.
Talk about DMC5. It's like my very first launch at Capcom as a brand director.
Yeah.
So, yeah, tons of people around the world worked on DMC5 to bring it home to you, and we're just so happy it's out. We're so happy Matt is here with us. So, man, let's get to it. And, like, you guys, like, enjoy this game. It is so freaking badass. You're going to love it. All right. Back to the Matt Walker Power Hour.
That's it. Thanks for coming today. No. No, seriously, like Max said, many of you are hardcore Devil May Cry fans, and you probably bought the game last night, and then you took a break to come here to not play the game.
Yeah.
So this has to be special, so we will make it special. So yeah.
But if you didn't buy a copy of the game, I have great news, because we are actually giving away 4 copies of the game on your console of choice. We have a raffle for that. And a custom Xbox One X, which is right here.
Look at that. That is a one of a kind.
It's got its own spotlight and everything. It's
there
great.
Are literally, there are only like, I think, 5 of those. Four. Thank you, Char. See?
And this is the first.
That is the first V console That is so, gonna have that is made by Microsoft.
We have this really impressively large jar with what doesn't look like a lot of tickets in here, but we'll be drawing that, which is good for whoever entered the raffle. If you didn't,
this could have been a cup.
Yeah. Honestly, I kind of wish we'd use something that wasn't transparent because it's just it looks like we caught bugs.
Or like a Halloween pumpkin or something. Yeah. I think could have worked really well. Either way.
Anyway,
put some Lon Lon milk in there, man.
We will get to that in a second, but first things first, I kind of want to talk a little bit about the sort of the road to DMC 5.
Right.
Because DMC 4 was, what, like a decade ago?
Yeah, it was over 10 years ago now.
It's been a minute. When did you guys get started on 5?
We started on 5 a little over 4 years ago. And, you know, we had come out with, like you said, Devil May Cry 4 over 10 years ago. And at that point, Ethan Ossan, he had already had Dragon's Dogma in his mind for a while. Actually, since DMC 2, since he was working on before he worked on DMC 2, he had an idea for this action RPG that he wanted to make. And so he was like, all right, I'm going to make this Dragon's Dogma. And then his boss came to him, I think it was back when Inafune-san was still around, and he's like, all right, Itsuno, well, new console's coming out, you're going to have to make a new Devil May Cry game. And he was like, all right, that's fine. Well, if we're going to do that, I don't want it to just be like Devil May Cry 3. I don't want it to just be about Dante, because where's the fun in that? So he came up with the idea for Nero, and Nero worked out pretty well. And then flash forward a couple of years after that, DMC 4 came out. Everybody liked it a lot. We were really happy with it. And then DMC Devil May Cry. You know, we weren't doing anything too much with the series, so we said, let's work with Ninja Theory. And Itsuno-san visited London constantly while he was making Dragon's Dogma in order to work with them on DMC Devil May Cry. And we brought that out, and I think it was about 2013. I should know this.
Sounds about right.
About 2013. Yeah. And that was fantastic. He really actually wanted to, he fully intended that we would have a DMC Devil May Cry 2, but kind of due to internal circumstances, that didn't come to fruition. So finally, getting to the point of your question, a couple years later, he's like, you know, I haven't seen any kind of what I like to call pure action games recently. We've seen a lot of amazing action games, a lot of games where, you know, the story has lifted video game storytelling to more established mediums, you know, like what we see in like movies and stuff. See all kinds of amazing open world stuff. But for Itsuno-san, he's like, look, I think there's this element to action games that hasn't changed in 30 years. That's what makes them fun. The idea that you come up against a challenge, and when you maybe you lose, maybe you don't, you know, get past that right away, but then when you do, you feel this immense sense of accomplishment. So he said, I'm going to make a Devil May Cry 5 and really make it with that in mind. So that was about 4 years ago now.
This game definitely does have this kind of purity to it. Like, it feels like you could very easily like strip away a lot there and it could be a game in another generation of console, but it has all of the slick polish we've come to expect from AAA games kind of right now. And
right.
You know, it doesn't reinvent the wheel, but it's also not like it's adding new stuff and it's shaking things up, but it's, you know, it feels very confident, you know?
Well, I mean, yeah, we worked super hard on it, and we, dude, like the lead animator is this guy that he's been at Capcom for a long time, but he started out his career at SNK. He's the guy that made Kyo and Iori at SNK, and he was the guy that was the lead animator for Dante and DMC 1. That guy just knows what makes Dante cool and what makes Devil May Cry cool. And he and the rest of the animation team had to put all of this effort, extra effort in, because, you know, we went for a more like photorealistic look for this game. And what we found out was that if it looks this realistic, when you do like gamey stuff like motion cancels, that really helps with the feel of the game, but that really sticks out. Mm. It's really apparent that, oh God, this is gamey. So those guys had their work cut out for them because they had to make all these really minor transition animations between all the different moves so that we still had a game that's as responsive as the other Devil May Cries, but didn't look out of place.
It's completely unrealistic in a lot of great ways.
Are you
but
sure?
It still has this like wonderful, like it's got this like spine of realism to it. And you have some behind the scenes footage of sort of, I don't know what we call this, like pre-visualization.
You're right, it's pre-visual.
A lot of people are, you know, they look at a game, they're like, oh, you do like performance capture, like mocap capture, like somebody has to like act this out with ping pong balls glued to them. This looks like the most insane like high school student film made by adults.
Are we going to show a little bit of that? Are we going to do that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, baby.
Can we do that?
Yeah.
We're going to roll a clip right now, and if you haven't seen something like this, you're in for a real treat. This is what it looked like before they added the graphics.
Okay, so so obviously video games are incredibly difficult to make, right? And you always hear about the sort of blood, sweat, and tears and everything goes into it. Everything in that video looked fun as hell. Like, that looked like you guys were having a blast. They were building toys. There's, like, toy cars. There's action figures doing stunts. There's no mocap ping pong balls or anything like that. How does that go from that into a video game?
That's a good question. I mean, so that's not the mocap. Is the thing. So this is, I mean, you guys are in production, so you guys know all about this. But I mean, really, there's a lot of different stages of production before something gets to be a final product. And with this, what we just saw here, like I said, like Max was saying, it's called previz. In the West, we call it previz. At Capcom in Japan, we actually call it viconte, which is video content. And the idea is that we want to know when we make the cutscenes, because we're going to spend all this money on, like you said, the mocap, mm-hmm. on rendering, on animation, to create a cutscene, right? And the cool thing about Devil May Cry 5 is that Devil May Cry 5 and RE2 is that there are no pre-rendered cutscenes. All that stuff is in RE engine. So it always blows my mind when I look at that, because it's like, Jesus, you can move the camera around with this, like, if you wanted to in the dev build. But you guys know all about this. You need a way to block for the camera to know that, okay, when we're taking a scene, when we need to know what's going to be on the camera, what's going to be seen, what's not going to be seen, so that you're not making more than you need to. Ideally, you know, if you did move the camera in that cutscene that's in the final game, there's literally like nothing there outside of what you see on the camera. That's what blocking means, right? Basically, what's blocking what on the camera. So this is really just blocking for the camera, and also a way for our engineers and our artists to get a sense of, okay, this is kind of what we're going for. And then we have lots of other stages where we kind of move up, and you know, we do like you said, mocap with different actors. Actually, a lot of these guys are the same actors. And
I was going to say, they seem too good to just leave here and not come back to.
Right. Yeah. Actually, you're right. Yeah. Most of these guys are actually the same mocap actors, except for, you know, like Dante is Ruben Langdon, for instance.
Mm-hmm. What about the van?
The van, Van Coon. Van Coon. Yeah, that's a good question. I don't think we mocapped the van.
I love the thought that somebody goes to like school for computer science for years and they show up and they're like, all right, time to make a video game. It's like, all right, you're making a cardboard van.
Yeah.
Get on it.
Well, and yeah, it's amazing, right?
Yeah.
But the cool thing is, at Capcom, we've been doing this on all of our games for years. So like Resident Evil 6 had this stuff, you know, Resident Evil Revelations 2, I worked on that. Like, we had this stuff. And I've always wanted to see this in our games.
Mm-hmm.
So we kind of had a goal for Devil May Cry 5 where, like, we want to say, look, we want to make this simple. So anybody that wants to buy the game, they can just get, like, the standard edition. They should get all of the relevant content in the game. And then we said, well, we got all this extra stuff. Like, we got these previous scenes, and we have, you know, we have ideas for, like, well, what if we made these kind of, like, different devil breakers, you know? Maybe we could put some extra music in the game from the old games as a kind of throwback. Could we not do something with that? And we thought, all right, well, you know what? If we make that something where we'll make it part of a deluxe package. So you could buy the deluxe package of the game, or you could just buy it as an upgrade, a DLC upgrade, and you can get this and all that stuff in there. And so that was finally our, we could finally get all these cool live action cutscenes in one of our games.
Which I love. I think everyone across the board appreciates not only that level of transparency and how something like this comes together, but also to be able to go and look at that whenever they want, because people will have iconic and favorite moments in this game and favorite cutscenes, and to go back to where it was in its idea form, you know, like somewhere between mocap and storyboarding, to be like, oh, this is where they were locking down the cinematography. This is what it looks like when, like, he's in front of a fan and his jacket's whipping in the background. Because it wasn't just, I think you guys, like, you're downplaying it a little bit. I think it wasn't just the blackout shots. I think it was also because it looked really cool. Like, I think to put a guy on a cardboard motorcycle and blow a fan in his face.
We got these people that everybody that works on these games in Japan and America too are just so passionate about it. You know, they just want to make the coolest thing they can. And this was at Toei Animation Studios, if I'm correct, which, you know, Toei is like one of the biggest, you know, studios in Japan. And they're just a bunch of really professional, really cool people that just want to do the coolest thing they can.
Well, it just looks like fun. Playing pretend.
It is. It is, yeah.
Also, I love that, like, it's got to be helpful to already have, like, you know, like PlayArt's Kai, like Dante figures to use.
Right?
Know? Yeah. It'd be like a pain in the ass if you had to make that out of clay or something.
I think that came from Itsuno-san's, like, personal stash. Because, you know, like, we go, all the different licensed items that get made come through now me and Okabe-san, the senior producer, and Itsuno-san, the director. So Itsuno-san's got, like, a personal collection of just all that different stuff. Because we usually get at least a sample of whatever it is that's getting made. And I think he just took that and said, all right, let's use this in the mocap. Or not the mocap.
He's got this, like, one-of-a-kind sample Dante is just made.
We do have a couple one-of-a-kind things in the office, yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, real quick, I think we're going to do a ticket greeting really quick and see who is going to win a copy of the game.
All right.
You want to do the honors?
Sure.
All right.
450-650. Nice.
All right. Well, hang out right there. Hang on to that ticket. Mark, remember his face. He gets a copy of the game. We'll sort that out later. We have like a prize counter or something.
Luckily, Mark's got a photographic memory. We have a system
here. All right.
Congratulations, though.
All right. So you mentioned the Devil Breakers.
All right. Yeah.
That's a new thing, yeah?
That is new.
Let's talk about that a little bit. Let's talk about sort of the new mechanics at play.
Cool. Is this, Mark, when we're going to do the De Niro footage or no? That's a yes. Okay. So just real quick for everybody watching the stream especially, if you haven't beaten the game yet, this particular footage is going to be a second playthrough piece of footage. So if you don't want to spoil yourself, they did a pretty good job on kind of hiding certain things. But you may or may not get spoiled on something if you watch this footage. So now's a great time for everybody watching from home. You know, pull up that Excel document that you've been using in case your boss comes around.
Mm-hmm. If you're in the room here today, you can cover your eyes. We have people around the room that will also cover your eyes for you. So just raise an arm. Or put your head down.
And then Brian will definitely let you know when it's not on the screen anymore.
Yes.
He'll do his trademark noise thing.
I'll make a sound.
That one. He'll do that thing. It'll be good. And let's do it. How about
Max?
Let's take a look. Nice hair, by the way, Max.
Thanks.
Nice.
I learned it from anime.
Nice.
Yes, yay for anime.
But yeah, the Devil Breakers. Let's talk about the Devil Breakers. So as I was saying before, I assume the footage is going to kick in at some point. There we go.
There it is.
In Devil May Cry 4, Izuno-san said, all right, I have a challenge for us. Let's create a brand new character, one that will rival Dante. That'll be just as cool as Dante. That'll be as legendary as Dante. And so they worked their butts off to try and create that character in Nero. And they came up with the idea of the Devil Bringer, right? His demon arm that he could use to kind of snatch and bring in enemies as well as throw enemies. And then when he came up with the idea for Devil May Cry 5, the first thing he thought was, what if I take that away from people now? How are they going to feel? And he was really going for a visceral reaction and said, oh my God, I love this Devil Bringer thing. What happened? Well, in its place now, I'm going to give you something even cooler, the Devil Breakers. So we still have the snatching functionality with the wire snatch. That is something that you can do. That's what he just did now. And you can snatch in enemies, which is this really cool thing. I always thought this was a great mechanic for Devil May Cry because Devil May Cry has always been about zoning enemies, you know, mm-hmm. having enemies grouped in a certain way. And the idea of, guess what, now you can just pull an enemy in, that really, really flips the action on its head. So
He's got 8 different Devil Breakers in place of the Devil Bringer that Nico has created. And they each have different moves. They have a regular Devil Breaker move, which you can just hit by, if you're using Xbox, then on the Xbox controller, it'll be the B button. And each one's going to have a certain move. For this Buster Arm, for instance, here, he's going to be able to do that Buster Throw that he had with the Devil Bringer. And I think he tried to do it now, and he just got hit. So because he got hit, switch to the next one, Gerbera. And then we also have a breakage move for each one, where you're going to hold in that B button for a couple seconds, and then the arm's going to like do sparkly fun stuff. And then when you let go, it's going to be like a super combo. It's going to be super badass. And he's got these 8 different options. And he's, of course, got the Red Queen and the Blue Rose that he uses to attack with.
Mm-hmm.
The idea there is, you can't switch the Devil Breaker on the fly. Now, we've seen a lot of people kind of give feedback on that. They're like, I want to be able to do that. Devil May Cry is about options, right? Well, Itsuno-san's vision was always that I want Dante and Nero to be differentiated. I don't want them to be the same experience, because then what's the point of having 2 separate characters? And with the Devil Breakers then, his vision has always been that there should be this macro gameplay that's different from Dante. So Dante, he is all about, you know, being able to switch your styles, being able to switch your weapons, both your melee and your ranged weapon on the fly at any given point in time. Nero is about planning out your Devil Breaker loadout before you go into the mission. Okay, here's how many slots I got. Here's the Devil Breakers that I have at my disposal. Here's what I want to have at the beginning of the mission. This is what I want to have in the middle of the mission. This is what I have at the end of the mission. And then when you come into the mission and you're using them, maybe you're going to find some on the ground. Maybe you're going to buy some from Nico's shop. Reevaluating at that point as well. And he was really hoping that could provide a differentiated experience for the gameplay. I think it does. You know, I think everyone's going to have opinions, and you know, everyone is entitled to their opinions. You know, I don't think Capcom should be telling people, you know, what to think.
I like that it's sort of reminiscent of another sort of familiar arm of a Capcom character. Mm-hmm. You know, having
are we talking about that particular one? Yeah, are we talking about the Mega Buster?
Allude to that,
right?
I forgot to tell everyone to cover their ears.
Sorry about that.
I was vague.
Nobody should have to listen to me.
Yeah, no, that's wonderful. Like, that's such a nice little, just a nice touch. Then of course there's a third playable character,
V.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. So you want to talk about V?
We can talk about V.
Are we going to talk about V? Are we going to switch over to V gameplay? Oh, that's right. V's already here. I guess we don't have to switch. And V is, as you were saying, the third playable character. When, again, right at that moment that Itsuno-san kind of got the okay to do a Devil May Cry 5 from the very top guy in the company, Kenzo Tsujimoto, he had the vision for the Devil Breakers, and he had a vision for, let's do a third playable character. And again, this character should be different from what we've seen with Nero and Dante, because if you just have the same character, kind of what's the point? You know, it's just another skin. So V, he thought, what if we take the portion of the character that you need to protect and separate that from the portion that attacks? And he thought, he can summon demons. Not just demons, but demons from DMC1, right? Shadow, You know, Griffin. Mm-hmm. You know, you guys know what I'm talking about, right?
Yeah, yeah. Are we trying? How much spoilers are we getting into here?
Well, I mean, this is all pretty common stuff. Like, as soon as you start this V, you're gonna know those guys. You're gonna know. And Nightmare. And so you're gonna have these 3 different characters these 3 different demons that you're gonna be fighting with as you're trying to protect V. And again, on a macro standpoint, it's, let's give people the chance to. They're going to have to approach gameplay a different way. It's going to be the same kind of framework. It's still the melee button is Shadow is your approximation of a melee attack, so that's your melee button. Griffin's your approximation of a ranged attack, so that's your range button. And then your Devil Trigger is going to be Nightmare. So it's the same framework, but now people have to keep their eye on the whole screen. Now it's not just, you know, Dante or Nero and the enemy. It's V's over here. You want to keep V separate. And then you have the different familiars, and then you have the enemies. So that's what we were going for with V.
Are you finding people are bouncing a lot between multiple play styles and experimenting a lot? Or do they kind of get in their comfort zones? And like, how do you, as game designers, drag them out of just mashing the same buttons over and over and getting a little more creative?
You know, that was something that we worked a lot on. And you figure, we actually haven't seen what people outside the company think yet, because the game just came out today, right? So I guarantee you that all the devs are scouring Twitter and everything else they can to really get a handle on how people feel about what we've made here. But for V, there's all this different risk-reward we tried to
implement in there. So yes, you want to keep him away, but you want to keep V away from the enemies, but V has to be the one to go in for the final kill. So he can't just always stay away.
Mm-hmm.
And so you want to play this little game of catch, really, where you want V to go in for the final kill after you've weakened the enemy, then get back out. Kind of get back in and get back out. And then we also implemented the idea that, well, with Shadow and Griffin, they're going to have a health bar. And once they've lost all their health, they're going to turn to this core, kind of like what you've seen in DMC1. And it's going to take them a certain amount of time to revive. So what if we make it so that when V gets closer to the core, they revive quicker? So there's, again, this risk-reward. Okay, there's going to be a risk in having to get closer to the downed familiar, but it'll be that much quicker for them to revive. And then finally with Nightmare, you know, what you can do is when you're in a pinch, you can, if you have one of them or both of them downed, you can call Nightmare and that revives both of them at the same time. And the game designers, you know, they experiment a lot with that kind of stuff to really make sure that the gameplay was something that was going to be robust and something fun for people and that would give them different options for playing.
Was this just extra difficult to have something completely brand new as opposed to sort of rooted in, you know, somewhat familiar gameplay?
For us, that was the goal. You know, the goal was it shouldn't just be the same thing, you know? It goes back to, well, what's familiar, that trying to keep in that same framework, we're hoping we'll keep it familiar enough for people that it'll be interesting for established fans, for instance. It's something new, but it's something they should be able to get. And then for new fans, hopefully, because they're coming in, they know about as much about V as a hardcore fan does right off the bat. So hopefully it's something that, if we've balanced the game right, they'll be able to get into as well.
Nice. How many playable characters are you going to have in Devil May Cry 6? Or is that too much to ask?
Man. Oh, we're talking about that now, huh? You know, it's actually funny that you mentioned that. I got a story. I'm sorry. I rambled a lot.
Go for it. No, go for it. That's why we have
you. We were at me and Pete Pizza, the other producer, the other kind of Western producer at R&D1 and Capcom in Japan. And it's me and it was some other Capcom people. Isamu-san was there. We were there with like the head editor of Famitsu. And we were there, we were hanging out at TGS, drinking at a hotel with someone from another Japanese game company. And they were like, you know, I'm really rooting for you guys because if DMC5 proves to be a success, then I can go to the people up top and go, look, there's this franchise that hasn't come out in a long time. And I can get those people to green light my thing. So I'm really rooting for you guys. So, I mean, we're really excited because Itsuno-san feels like there's something to this gameplay that we haven't seen in a little while. And we're hoping that people will be able to enjoy. But it's kind of cool to know that there's other Japanese developers there rooting for us too, you know?
Yeah, no, that's awesome. Yeah. I think it's like, it's sort of what we're seeing from, you know, Capcom as a whole. It's they're bringing back a lot of the classics and they're knocking it out of the park. But that said, are there a lot of expectations when you're not there for a long time? You know, DMC5 was kind of in the oven for a very long time, right? And this sort of people were thinking about what's next, and there's a lot of expectations from fans, and there's probably a lot of feedback and a lot of noise. Like, how do you try to satisfy everybody, or do you just say we're going to do our best and we hope everyone loves it?
I mean, on the dev side, we do pay attention to what people are saying, you know, and especially now, you know, since Pete and I have been over there, we have tried to kind of be an open conduit to an extent. We share stuff with people on the dev side because, you know, they speak, you know, they're Japanese people, so they don't speak English the way we do. They might not get things the way they do. Sometimes Itsuno-san comes to me and goes, hey, what's this mean? But we try to pay attention to everything. But then at the same time, really, what it comes down to is, there's a little bit of faith that we just have to have in the developers because, like, Itsuno-san, he's got a vision for what he wants to do. And him and the other game designers, they're going to focus on that. And really, any game that Capcom puts out, regardless of whether it's DMC5 or RE2 or, I don't know, like, what's something, like RE6, okay? Those are all, in the end, I mean, all those are just a bunch of people working really hard to make the thing they think is going to be cool.
Yep.
And they hope that people are going to like. So when Itsuno-san and I were backstage at the MS conference last year for E3, we were really nervous because we were really happy with what we've done with this game. You know, we did change the graphics. You know, Nero especially looks a bit different from what he did in DMC4. So we were really nervous. How are people going to receive this? And we were so relieved when we're backstage and the trailer goes up, and you see Capcom, and you can hear everybody in the theater going, oh, what is this? What is this? And then some people recognize Nero, some people recognize the Red Queen, and everybody starts kind of like getting a little louder. And then when Devil May Cry comes up on the van, everybody went apeshit, man. Everybody's like just going nuts. And so Ethan LaSalle and I are backstage, and we're like, yes! We were just so relieved. And the whole dev team, you know, were relieved at that point too, because God, we're super lucky throughout the whole process. Everybody has just been super positive to us, you know.
How did that compare to the game actually coming out?
Well, I mean, the game came out today, right?
So yeah, so you haven't had enough time to sort of soak that in yet?
Yeah.
No, people like it. The reviews have really been out for a few days. You know, right? This is like it's an incredibly positive outpouring around this game.
You know?
So that's got to be... takes a little bit of weight off your chest, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's not real to me yet.
I mean, you got people like him asking about the next game already, so it's like, obviously... Yeah.
There's always going to be that.
There's no rest.
Oh, but I mean, like, seeing the review scores come out and seeing, like, such a high Metacritic and stuff, it's like... That's kind of the first thing, right? That's the first thing. It's we are always very thankful that reviewers and media pay attention to our games, because I think, this is my own personal opinion, I think we all need each other, man. I know you see a lot of hate online. You know, you might see like, you know, developers or reviewers or fans all kind of going at each other. But it's like, we all need each other, man. Mm-hmm. We all need each other. Like a place like Capcom, and we have friends in Capcom Europe who called Capcom a boutique publisher. And compared to like an EA or an Activision, there's some truth to that, you know? Mm-hmm. So we need people in the media and fans that are going to help us kind of get the word out about our games. And, you know, we need the fans, because if we don't make a product that people are going to like, then they're not going to buy it. And then we can't make any more games, right? That's just the way it works. We got a chance to see the reviews yesterday. It's been fantastic. Today, we finally get to see people are actually going to, actual fans, actual players are going to be able to get the game in their hands and play it.
Yeah.
And we can't wait to actually get online and start seeing that. I was on Twitch earlier, just trying to get on a couple streams, just kind of see how people are enjoying themselves and playing the game. And it's been fantastic.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm. And the buzz is good. And, oh, by the way, we've got two more copies of the game to give out to the people here.
All right.
So get out this underwhelming jar once again. We're doing two this time, so why don't you each pick one?
Thank you to the good folks at Staples for providing these tickets.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Staples. Look at that.
Apologies to
keep
the manufacturers
this
of this jar. All right.
Do you want to go first?
All right. 650-652. And that was for nothing.
That was a very dramatic reading.
Yeah,
did we miss somebody?
Should we read it again?
650-652.
Anybody?
Going once?
I can read mine.
Going twice?
All right, let's do yours. Yours right. Be
we'll do mine, and we'll do another one from here. 450-643. Yes!
All right.
Yes!
All right.
Cool. Second row.
Hold
good
on
job,
to your ticket. We will talk at the end. Do you want to read yours?
All right, we're going to do it again.
Okay.
Should I do a dramatic assignment?
Once more with family.
Should we throw this one in the garbage?
Yeah, let's get rid of it. That's a cursed ticket. Get this out of here.
The cursed ticket.
Ghost put that in there.
450-617. I'm really bad at this. I'm really bad at this.
Don't gamble, ever.
450-617.
Yeah!
All right! Do it in the back!
Okay.
All right, hold on
That's
to it.
That's right!
Hold on to it.
All right, cool. So
the curse has been lifted.
Thank God. I mean, I'm never going to be as good as Oprah, but
we have a boss fight.
All right, we got a boss fight. Sweet. So we're doing Dante then.
I'm not sure actually.
All right,
Mark, why don't you roll the clip and we can talk about it?
It'll be a surprise.
It's a surprise boss.
Oh, there you go, Dante.
There it is. Okay.
Yeah. Our sexy European model that we scanned for him. All of them. Fun fact. All the characters are European models.
Is it Halloween already?
Really? They're all very hot European models.
Did they all show up in their own leather jackets, or did you guys make them?
No, we made them. We actually worked with this amazing lady from the BBC to create these BBC-level high-quality costumes. And I don't know As far as I know, there aren't any other publishers that, do this, but at Capcom, we did this for this, and we did this for RE2, and we did this for Revelations 2, actually. And we created, like, high-quality costumes that we then scanned these models in. And so you get this level of fidelity in some of the details that you wouldn't get in a lot of other games.
Right.
Because that's a real thing. And we scanned it, and there were actual, like, wrinkles in there and stuff. And there's a whole bunch we could talk about in terms of, like, okay, what are the technical limitations of that and stuff. I won't talk about that. But it looks kind of cool, doesn't it?
We'll have you back in another time to talk leather jackets. I'm really into that.
Sweet.
In the meantime, tell us about who this awful, awful giant Batman is.
That is Cavalier Angelo. And if you're a Devil May Cry fan, you know about Angelo. Well, one of the Angelos here. Cavalier Angelo. He's one of the bosses in the game. And this is Dante wrecking him up. Now, who did you guys have doing the gameplay here?
That's probably Mitchell.
Yeah.
Our buddy Mitchell.
Yeah, he's nasty.
He does okay.
Man, he kicked some proverbial butt.
Yeah, I was hoping we'd have a little more time to, like,
he's going to put that in his business card.
This life bar is just
kicking
disappearing.
Kicking proverbial butt. Yeah. Mitchell. Yeah. What's Mitchell's last name?
Saltzman.
There you go. Mitchell kicking proverbial butt Saltzman.
Yeah.
There you go. And you see, I mean, you can see he's using all of Dante's styles. You know, he's not afraid to get in there with the Balrog gauntlets. He's already got a Savage. And, oh, he got hit.
One day we're going to find a game that Mitchell's bad at, but yeah. I haven't seen it yet. It's just, it's kind of ridiculous.
Has he gotten first place in Tetris 99?
Oh, I'm sure. Usually I have to go online to
second
prove to myself that I'm bad
only
at video
second.
Games.
Oh, Mitchell's here.
With him, I just
you only got second place, so there you go. He didn't win, mm-hmm. So you found one. You found one, Brian. You win at life.
There it is.
Nice.
Yeah, no, he's making quick work of this, though. So,
yeah.
How do you... You clearly have a very tactile approach to making the cutscenes and the jackets. What goes into a boss?
Man, well, we got game designers. Very specific, there'll be a game designer for a boss or two. So, for instance, the game designer that worked on the first boss and the last boss is the same guy. A guy named Yoshi-san. He's really cool, actually. And we have a very specific game designer that works on maybe one or two bosses and maybe some other stuff. And they go day in and day out and they go, okay, this is going to be the move layout for the boss. Okay, these are the parameters we're going to need. Talking to the programmers to get those parameters implemented so that they can then, from their desk, use the framework, use RE Engine to tune everything, you know, in terms of, okay, how much is each... When I hit the boss, how much damage is there going to be? When the boss hits me, how much damage is there going to be? You know, how many... Sometimes they can actually edit the animations to an extent, you know? And also that we can make this boss fight as cool as possible. And there's just constant back and forth about, all right, well, you know, I think we should have, like, this special effect. So then you have to bring in people from the special effects team to create all these amazing special effects that we have.
There's a lot of effects there.
There's a lot of effects, yeah.
There's a lot of stuff going on there.
Electricity.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that, because obviously you can make a cardboard van and use action figures, but for the lighting effects in this game, which I feel like you just kept saying, just keep going, make it more and more crazy. How does that happen? Like, is there ever a point where you're like, no, we have enough now? Because it seems like you kept just adding more and more, and it's really gorgeous.
I mean, there's always going to be a baseline of kind of what people want to do, what the artists want to do in the engine, and there's going to be a lot of back and forth between the engine team and the title team to get that implemented. You know, anything that we want in there, especially during DMC5 and RE2, you know, RE Engine was for Resident Evil 7, right? So there was... That game was very grounded in reality, right? It was this kind of first person, very grounded in reality. There weren't a whole lot of special effects. And so one of the challenges we had was, well, this engine currently doesn't have a whole lot of flashy special effects, which we need for Devil May Cry. Devil May Cry needs that stuff, right? So we worked really hard on getting that kind of stuff implemented, for instance, in the engine. And then, you know, the team working with that to get the look out of it that they wanted for all that different stuff.
That's awesome.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, no, it looks fantastic.
Cool.
Yeah, there's like an impressive amount of sort of almost gaudiness to this. You guys literally brought a neon sign here.
Yeah, dude.
Surprisingly.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know
Devil
if anybody
Cry
on
5
the stream
neon sign
it,
is always here, but, you know.
Our amazing PR people. created that thing.
Yeah.
And yeah, they sent it to just like a couple of very exclusive outlets, like, hey, we have a Devil May Cry sign for you. So the great thing is, I know that in the next, you know, X number of years, whenever I come here, you guys will always have the Devil May Cry sign up in the IGN offices, won't you? And I'm very much looking forward to that.
We will. It's actually surprisingly difficult to get rid of some of the things that get sent to this office. So it's a permanent fixture from now on.
That Donkey Kong Jr. machine over there is impressive.
I've tried to steal that like 10 times. They won't let me. I think that's like sort of part of the mantra of Devil May Cry in general, right? It's not only the lighting effects. It's not only the big jackets. It's everything is sort of wonderfully over the top and kind of unabashedly fun.
Yeah.
And I think that brings in a certain level of fandom of people who just appreciate how kind of ridiculous it can get. How do you up the ante with that kind of stuff? Like, how do you keep going over and over the top with these things?
I mean, the style, first of all, the style really comes from Itsuno-san and kind of his vision of what like a Devil May Cry game should be. And that all really comes from what he thinks is cool. And what he thinks is cool is basically what like kids in their early teens think is cool. Like, yeah, I mean, we call that, we actually have a term for that in Japanese, and I can't wait because people on the internet are going to be like, that's not what that means. And I look forward to them correcting me. But I mean, I take Chunie as like basically, yeah, the kind of stuff that like kids in their early teens think is cool. So stuff like, you know, guitars and motorcycles.
Kissing.
Fire. Ew. Ew, Brian. Jeez. No.
There's no kissing in this game, you guys.
No kissing. Don't give me the cooties. No cooties.
Everyone just got really
no
sad.
No cooties.
So it's like teen brain, basically.
Yeah, I mean, you know, but like, but and so that's where, like, for instance, the Cavalier weapon comes from. It's a motorcycle that splits into dual chainsaws. Because of course it does. It's a motorcycle. That's what they do. You know, that kind of thing. Or like, you know, we have like...
You can't come up with that when you're like a boring old man. That's teen brain.
Well, that's the thing. He sounds not a boring old man. That's for sure, man.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
We actually had one thing that we didn't... That, you know, we especially for Dante, we're like, all right, what weapons are going to be in that vein? You know, we're kind of coming up with different ideas. And one of the things, one of the ideas that we had that we didn't go through with was... When we were coming up with those, ice skating was a big thing in Japan. So we're like, what if there was an ice skating weapon for Dante? But that didn't work. So
you guys could have made history.
You know,
it would have been like Yuri on ice.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was saying.
Yeah.
Next time. Devil I think we're building ice. A Devil May Cry 6 right here today. I think that's
oh,
like,
man, right here.
Yeah, yeah. I'm glad we're recording right this. You guys, when you're stumped in a few years, go back and be like, we got to bring back that ice skating thing.
There you go. Be like, and Brian kissing. Altano wants us. And kissing.
I want to, like, eventually, like, clearly going over the top isn't really an issue here, but I want to see, like, what this franchise looks like in, like, 20 years and just where it's like, it's clearly off the rails and it can't even see the rails. The rails are far behind it.
Yeah,
you've got chainsaw motorcycle halves and purple lightning. Like it's good. Keep getting weird. We have one more game to give away and then we're going to do some questions from you guys in the audience.
All right.
Want to do the honors?
All right.
Let's do
you
it.
You have the worst luck of this so far.
I do have the worst luck. And it's not just with this either. I'm just like, I'm just kind of a wreck in general. you can ask my wife. All right. 450-649.
That's
all right.
Oh,
yeah. Hold on
to
that.
Also, I'm really sorry to everybody whose ears I've totally blown out on the stream with all of my all rights and all that stuff.
Nah, you're doing great.
Cool, thank you.
It's okay. I'm sure the electric guitarist from Devil May Cry have already done the necessary damage. All right, so we're going to do questions from the audience. Do we have like a mic here?
We do.
Right.
Once again, thank you to everybody for coming out.
Seriously,
today.
Yeah.
And
this has been a really good time.
I know, I saw, all you guys. I saw the line of you guys starting out there when we came in here a couple hours ago.
Mm-hmm.
Where's Sarah? Is Sarah in here somewhere? That's Sarah, isn't it? Sarah, your friend was at GameStop last night. She's like Sarah with the pork tattoo. She's awesome. So there you go. There you go. You got it. You got it, sister.
That's awesome.
Yeah, man. All right, I'm sorry. Sorry.
No, all right. No, no worries.
All right, questions. Who wants to do a question? Right there. What? Where's the mic? I don't... Okay, where are we? Okay, go to this man with the microphone.
Nice, with a bomber jacket.
We have an obstacle course set up. You can't see it.
Right, true. Right.
Yeah.
We have to make sure your question's really good, so it's very difficult to go ask it.
All right.
Right.
Okay, first I just want to say congratulations on the launch of the game.
Thank you.
And then second, I'm sure that your answer is going to be a neither confirm nor deny. But I just wanted to ask you, so there's a lot of William Blake mythology and content in this game. Most notably, V speaks his poetry and refers to the big bad guy as Urizen. I think I pronounced that correctly.
Urizen, you got it, you got it.
Yeah. But more subtly, Nico has a tattoo on her rib cage of the poem Eternity, and she also has two bird tattoos, which could allude to the bird's poem by William Blake. And I was wondering if there's some history or connection between Nico and V that we can't tell from the trailers because they haven't had any real interactions. And I just wanted to know if I'm in over my head and reading too much into these things, or if there's some reason that it's especially these two characters that show William Blake influence.
Right on, right on. I mean,
she sounds like she's onto something.
I love it. I love it, man. I mean, that's exactly, we want people, we really want people to kind of really think a lot about it, you know? And I think really what you want to hear from me is, I can neither confirm nor deny what's going on there. But please play the game.
Okay, I will.
I love, yeah, we went full William Blake there. Mm-hmm. I love it. You got like, yeah, we got chainsaw motorcycles, but also classical poetry.
The birds. Mm-hmm. You got
some,
it, exactly.
Some deep cut stuff there. Next question.
I noticed with questions like that, by the way, you have to, because you're not going to say the answer, but it's watching your face. Like you got to look for the tells. So the answer, the truth is in there somewhere. Got to replay the tape.
All right.
The truth is, I don't know what I'm doing.
We really should have planned this better with the tables.
I think it's going great.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Okay, so this is probably a dumb off-the-wall question. But
no such thing.
There are no dumb questions.
What do you think Dante's like opinion would be in regards to pineapple on pizza?
Ooh, man.
Ooh.
That's a fantastic question. Good God.
Hey, no politics.
Good God. We've asked. I know, right? There are no dumb questions, only dumb politicians. So, I went there. We've talked to Ethan about this. Like, well, what's Dante's favorite pizza? And he's like, well, pepperoni is Dante's favorite pizza.
Smart man.
Pepperoni. Whether or not he likes pineapple is not something that I am allowed to decide. I'm sorry. I'm pretty sure if I like gave a canon answer there, like Ethan Osan would be like, Matt, you're not allowed to do that. So, I'd like to know.
What?
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I think what you want to hear from me is, I can neither confirm nor deny.
What are your thoughts?
Thank you for the lore breaking question.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you for the lore breaking question. We're going to get more of those now. It's going to be great. And I'm going to have the most boring answers for everybody.
What are your thoughts on the pineapple pizza thing?
Dude, I'm all about Hawaiian pizza, man.
Okay.
I'm from Michigan, so like.
Agree to disagree. Yeah.
Really? You don't like pineapple?
No.
Do you like
no.
mushrooms?
Yes.
You like mushrooms?
Yeah. Not man. Like a, as
you're
a regular
a grown
thing.
Man. You're a grown man.
Yeah, yeah, you know.
Well, there's a lot of guys I know that like they just don't eat like they don't eat mushrooms. A lot of guys don't eat vegetables. Like,
they're babies. Man. That's not a grown man. That's a baby.
Fair enough. There you go. Brian Altano throwing down the gauntlet.
All right. Next question.
Poor Max.
Any more pizza topping ones? Or I was just like, this could get messy if we get into like the pineapple debate.
Pizza
here.
Gets messy.
All right.
Hello.
What's up?
I just want to say, first of all, thank you so much for bringing this game finally to us. I've been playing DMC since the first one in 2001, I believe.
Baby, you got it.
So, incredibly honored.
Yeah.
My question is pretty simple. What caused the continuity change in the series? Because it used to be 3-1-4-2, and now 5 is apparently... after 4, which is now after 2. So I just want to know behind the scenes, what was the story behind that?
At any other company, I would have to be like, I can neither confirm nor deny. But luckily, I can actually talk about this one. Sweet.
Yay.
Yeah. So it's interesting, right? The way the series kind of worked out, right? So Kamiya-san made DMC 1, right? And then, He kind of went on and did some other stuff. And the guys up top were like, great, we're going to make a DMC 2. And so there was a team that was working on that. And those guys had a really tight schedule and a really tight budget they had to work on. So DMC 2, you figure it was like, all right, great. Well, it comes after DMC 1 because of course it does, right? They brought in Itzan Ozan. Itzan Ozan, basically Itzan Ozan's boss came to him and he's like, look, these guys are having problems. We need to get this out the door, like, on time. Who do you think could work on this? And Itzan Ozan's like, well, what about this guy? What about this guy? What about this person? And they're like, oh, no. Those people, they're all busy on other projects. All right, you're going to have to do it. So Itzan Ozan had to work on DMC 2. And then he and a bunch of other guys were like, look, we want to show that we can make a proper action game. And we're going to do that with DMC 3. They made DMC 3. He thought, all right, I want to make the Dante that I want to make. All right, so this might not be the same Dante that you guys are used to. Okay, the original Dante, maybe he's the kind of guy that he's too cool to get hit. He's too cool to take, you know, to take it, because he's too cool to even, you know, he can just evade everything, right? DMC 3 Dante, Itsuno, as I was mentioning with like the Chun-Li stuff, he likes a character that, you know, that will take it on the chin and will have like the blood running down his face, but then that character will get back up and be like, all right, I'm about to kick some ass. And so in order to do that, then he thought, well, I can put, if I make it a prequel, if I make DMC 3 a prequel, then I could do that. It will make sense. It would make, you know, logistical sense for Dante to not be, you know, that cool yet. And so he did that. And then they made DMC 4. And it was like, all right, well, DMC 4 is going to come at the end, right? Well, not at the end, right? We decided that it was going to be DMC 4 and then 2, right? So when he came up with the ideas for DMC 5, he's like, all right, well, for this to work actually in the timeline, I'm going to have to rearrange the timeline. And he really hated having to actually talk about this at all at first, because, you know, I think we don't want to disappoint people and be like, oh, actually, you know what? We changed things. But it makes more logistical sense for this if we change it back and go, okay, the continuity is then 3, 1, 2, 4, 5. So long answer. I hope it was enough for you.
Completely satisfactory.
Cool. Thanks, man.
Thank you very much.
Nice.
I love that you could answer that, but you couldn't answer the pineapple thing. So we'll talk about multiple timelines, but pineapple?
But not pineapple. No, God, no, not pineapple.
Got to sign
no.
an NDA for that one.
In a long enough timeline, you can put pizza under anything or pineapple on anything, whichever. That's a better question. How do you feel about pizza under pineapple?
Pizza under pineapple.
What?
Yeah, exactly.
Pizza get out. All right.
Any more questions?
Blowing my mind,
all right.
Mike Scoville.
Come on, somebody just come on up. There's a microphone. This is the last one.
Mark says this is the last
one. But then after that, we're going to give away an Xbox One X, which is also fun. So.
All right.
It's Sarah. What's up, Sarah? Yeah.
Okay, so real quick, I know you talked about how you scanned all of the model for Dante. I did see that concept art where it shows everything, and I will say great.
All right.
Thank you.
Nice.
Thank you for helping some of the fan base who plays this game for not just the action. It's great.
Sweet.
My question is about the music. I love every theme for every character. I will say that Crimson Cloud took over my spot for Devil Trigger very fast.
Nice.
It's very Trent Reznor mixed with dark goth, and I really, really dig it.
Cool.
But I was wondering how you went around creating all of those themes, because if you look at Devil May Cry 4, Nero had Never Surrender, which is totally different than what Devil Trigger is. And yep. I was just wondering how you went from, because Dante having heavy metal, I can see that. V having dark goth, I can see that. But Nero having this awesome, like, dubstepy.
Yeah.
Rock theme is a little bit different, but I still really dig it. And I was wondering how you guys went around designing all those themes, especially V's, because I just really, really love
nice,
it.
Nice, right? Nice. Unfortunately, I don't have any really, really good stories about V's, but for those three battle songs, right? For Devil Trigger and Subhuman and Crimson Cloud, Itzan Ozan was working with the sound guys. There's the lead composer is a guy named Kota Suzuki. He's really cool. He worked with me on Resident Evil Revelations 2, for instance. And they're like, all right, look, first of all, for Devil Trigger, they were like, look, Nero's kind of be the main character of the game, essentially. Let's change it up. Let's actually have female vocals this time. And so that kind of helped lead us to working with Casey and Ali Edwards. And they had visions for all three of them. They wanted all three of the songs to be different and something that kind of, as you've already indicated, something where it seems like this character would listen to this, you know? So that's kind of where that like a little more poppy, and I really shouldn't say anything about the genre because I know that the sound guys have very specific, every time I ask them, like, what's the genre of this song, essentially? Like, you know, I haven't really been into music at all since 2007 when I moved to Japan. I don't know what's going on in the world anymore. And they'll give me like, well, it's not this, it's a mix of this, and this. And every time I try to say that, I screw it up. So I'm not going to say what kind of music it is, but, you know, it is like a little poppier, right? And that was the idea there was like, you know, Nero's kind of, maybe he's in his 20s or so, you know, and it makes sense that he would listen to something that's a little more, you know, like that. Whereas, you know, Dante, he's kind of an older man now. So that's where the heavy metal comes from. And then V, again, it's like, we're doing something completely new with V. Let's do something completely different with Crimson Cloud. Yeah. Thank you. Nice shirt.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Nice.
Remember, she's got an awesome Porg tattoo, too. So for anybody that likes Star Wars.
It's Porg.
Porg.
I wanted to ask just
Miguel. Sorry, one more thing about the Porg. I'm sorry, Max. I know at this point you probably know it as hell with me. Miguel Cordy, the head of Capcom localization, hates Porgs. So please tweet at him with as many Porg pictures as possible. Please. For me. Thank you.
Images, GIFs, everything you have. So, yeah.
I love that. I'm always curious to sort of see what kind of pop culture gets into people's brains when they're working on other pop culture. Like, clearly you've got, you know, bits of William Blake. You've got, you know, industrial music. You've got bits and pieces of everything. Like, was there anything making Devil May Cry 5 that you were, was kind of like in the back of your head, or that you guys were like, we want to do something that's like akin to that?
Nope.
Oh, crap. There goes my question.
I mean, you know, it's Devil May Cry, right? So like really, really the most important thing is that it's Devil May Cry. And we get asked a lot like, oh, okay, are there, you know, there's all these different video games that have come out, you know, these amazing video games that have come out in the last couple of years. Did you reference any of that stuff? And Itsuno San's always like, nope. Like, you know, it's like, the most important thing, first of all, is that it feels like a Devil May Cry game, or else right. It's like, well, why isn't it like a completely different IP, you know? So, Nope.
Make your own thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
I dig it. All right. So we have the Xbox One X limited edition, 1 of 4 to give away right now. And to make things fair to everybody who already won a copy of the game, it would suck to win a game but not get a copy of the console. So we're going to just throw these.
I'll throw them back
here.
In.
We're going to throw them back in. So now everybody in the room has a chance to win this. Matt, do you want to do the honors?
Baby.
You've had the worst luck with this.
I've had the worst luck. We're going to do this the longest.
All right.
The stream's never going to end. This is your hell, all of you. I'm sorry. I'm sorry for swearing. Are we not allowed to swear?
It's okay. I mean, your game has like dudes with like guns that kill people and stuff, so you can curse all you
want. Alicia, Capcom PR, wherever you are, I love you. I'm sorry. I'm very sorry. I love you. You're a wonderful person. Just say no. All right. Here we go. Watch it be one of the ones that I called out earlier that we didn't have. 4-5-0. Now we're going to do all three of us. I'm going to go 6. Next is Brian.
So 4-5-0-6-3.
Huh. It's kind of hard to make out.
I think it's a P.
4-5-0-6-3-3.
And the price is
nobody.
Really not right.
Wait.
Yeah?
Yeah, dude.
There was some confusion. Like, I thought we had, like, handed in, so I talked to a guy and he actually brought 2 tickets up.
What? Oh, boy.
Mark, did you screw this guy over?
No. All right. Well, that's anticlimactic.
Mark, find the ticket, dude.
Let's.
What'd you do with the ticket, Mark? Did you put it in a paper shredder?
Okay.
Right. We put the contest settings on hard mode today, so.
Oh, you good?
All right.
Okay.
The price is
all
right.
There we are. That's the most anticlimactic raffle winning. You won an Xbox.
A one-of-a-kind Xbox.
All right.
And the winner is La La Land.
You're probably going to be able to make
Nicely done.
Nice.
All right, so now we have pizza with all sorts of toppings, and we have ice cream. And
the pizza and the ice cream are separate things, by the way.
Unless you want to get real weird.
Unless you're
Brian.
A Ninja Turtle.
Yeah. Cowabunga.
Nice.
Matt, thank you so much for coming by.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Awesome.
Max, I'm really sorry. I know
Can
you've
we get
been
a round of applause?
This.
No.
Yeah, baby.
Give it up for Matt. Give it up for Devil May Cry. And thank you guys so much for being here today.
Yeah, huge thanks to Capcom for helping this whole thing come together. Normally, we don't have pizza and ice cream for everybody who comes by, but if you ever want to come by IGN again, we usually do first Fridays on the first Friday of every month. So thanks for joining us, and let's go eat some pizza.
All right.